So I'm going to talk a bit about the courses at Lisbon University, specifically in the humanities. So the School of Arts and Humanities has the four main areas: linguistics, languages and culture, history and philosophy. And of course, I'm in the linguistics area, so I'll be talking from that point of view. And recently, the Portulan Clarion has started, and this probably will have quite an impact in everything that we are doing right now, because it does support all the humanities, not only linguistics and language in specific. And for now, we have been collaborating with the area of language and culture, and it has been quite interesting. So it is true that most of the Clarion contents have been quite important for research more than really in the teaching curricula. And this is something that we discussed already at the workshop. Everyone that is in research or at least in the PhD programs is strongly interested in this content, less when we are talking about bachelor courses, and we have experienced this. Okay, just to give you an idea of what we have tried at a certain point at the school. So we have a course in corpus linguistics at master degree, and it involves corpus compilation, collocations, query, annotation. I'll discuss it in a bit more detail after this slide. And also a discourse analysis course at bachelor and master degree. And here the idea was to give them a perspective of what is annotation. What do you do when you do annotation of a corpus? And this was an example with this course, and we used the PDTV style of annotation. And it was quite interesting when we did it at the master level and again at the bachelor level. Well, they would prefer to just have a test and not really making something so specific as going into corpus annotation. And then we have seminars and workshop on very specific topics that are quite interesting for people at bachelor, not bachelor, but master degree and PhD. So text encoding, markup, annotation, standards, everything that Clarion is in fact concerned about. And this has been quite interesting. So I'll give you some examples afterwards. Could you? So this was the course in corpus linguistics. It was a bit more than corpus linguistics. We were three teachers, and this is still online, in fact. So I think most of our exercises are still there. A part is in Portuguese, but the rest is in fact in English. And these are the topics. So you have two parts. The first part was very straightforward for the students. They really liked it. We were talking about master's students. So they were very interested in corpus compilation, queries, representation, the spoken corpora, how do you transcribe and align text to sound. And all this was very interesting for them because it related to their own resources and things that were very practical they wanted to do. So we had some exercise and also some slides with very practical information for them. And then the second part was more technical. It's introduction to Unix, linguistic annotation, phraseology and collocations from the point of view of extracting that information with not as friendly tools. So this was a bit more difficult for our students. They felt it was probably something they didn't really need because they want something that would run on Windows, and Unix would be more difficult for them to access because they don't have a server, they don't have Linux computers. So we did find a certain resistance to this part of our course. So something that was very useful, and we felt it when we were giving this corpus at the master level, and we came back to it at certain seminars and courses. That's the text encoding, that's the annotation, because they really, all of them are related to some kind of resource they are producing, and they want standard, they want to know how to proceed. So I'm just giving you an example of something related to a learner corpus, the couple two corpus, and this involved the text encoding initiative standards, the representation in XML, and we were using Taytalk, that's a corpus management and graphical interface. And you can see, I think you can see, the cases where the student wrote down and corrected what he was writing, and we are able to, in XML, represent all the variations, all the deletions, additions, and to view this online. So this is something that started in linguistics, So it started in linguistics with the learner corpus, and then we saw that our colleagues that were working with old texts wanted to use it because they also have some marks that they want to add in their text and different versions of the text and also normalization of the text. So they're using exactly the same graphical interface, the same XML markup, and it was quite interesting to see that something that started for one purpose could be reused for something else. Okay, we see that then it went to something completely different. Our colleagues were very much interested, the ones using digital scholarly editions and producing these editions. And they'd been doing it from a very different point of view, but they wanted to go digital. And they had this problem of dealing with several versions of the same text, and they wanted to align this text and have several versions visible. So they're also dealing with XML representation. They reused most of what we were doing. This is already a literature area. And they're not using TayTalk, but the versioning machine, because it shows several versions of the text, same text online. And this is the corpus of one of our colleagues. And you can see it's more or less the same questions that she has to deal with. Some spans that were deleted, some spans that were added. So we are sharing the same concerns. So if I want to sum up our experience, I would say that the students have reacted and the researchers have reacted very positively to the contents that are more related to everything that they have to do for their own research and something that they can do without much knowledge of computational linguistics, of Unix, or anything more advanced. If you go to more advanced contents, then they will back up a bit. But this was very positive to the students. And I would say that if we really want to involve the humanities at our school, we want to look at something that is common, some common issues in the humanities that everyone is concerned with. Because, of course, for us, it's language. But in fact, we're all dealing with text, text or sound. And text is a common perspective from us. So we all need standards for text encoding. We have multiple versions of a text or handwritten documents. We need standards for representing this. We need some shared documentation. And what we had was a documentation for one project that has been passed by several projects and reused and adapted by these projects. So it's quite interesting that now we have several different versions that very much alike. And we want some shared examples of an XML structure. That's the first thing they wanted. So, okay, we want to do this. Do you have any example of the XML that we should be using, which components we should be integrating or not? So I would say these are the questions that everyone is facing right now. And I see immediate applications to history. So the next step is to contact our colleagues in the history department, because they do have the text, they have the same questions they have to deal with. And I'm sure they would be thrilled to know that we have some experience in this. And we can not only represent the text, but then add some annotation on top of it, the part of speech, the lemmatization, that would be very useful. So we are spreading very cautiously, but I think we are getting more partners to Clarin in the humanities at the school.